Pastor, you're the first one to join. I'm just making a note. It will be in. Actually, my computer is a little loud. For those who are already on the IG Live, let me know if you guys can hear my computer running or not. I'm curious. Or I don't want it to be too loud for you. Yay! Surprise! It's not Pastor, it's me. I hope everyone's doing good and is blessed. Yeah. Okay, good. I'm glad you guys can hear me perfect. I have the Uber conference running as well, and my computer was just a little loud, so I wasn't sure if it was too much. Did I say that? Let me make sure I pin it. Oh. I'll just give everybody, girl, right? Pastor gets to be in the comments now. So funny. Hey. Pastor is super excited. Super excited. We just got off the phone a few minutes ago. It was so funny. Hello, hello, everyone. I will be giving the word today. Pastor's in the comments though, so she'll be commenting. I hope everyone is blessed. I tried to pin the topic, but it didn't work. I'll have to try it again. So maybe you guys can just type it in the comments for me and keep everybody on track. I think that would, oh, it did pin. Oh, okay. So it's just not showing for me. Okay, good. Hello, hello, everyone. It pinned for a moment. Huh? Let me give the, I'll give the scripture here again. Just a moment. I'm just going to type. So you guys are going to hear me typing for a minute. I'm excited about the message the Lord gave me. It blessed me. So I really pray it blesses everybody else. Just typing, and then I will open up in prayer, and then we'll get started. 15, 48. Oh, you know why? I guess maybe because the comments are coming so quick. It's not pinning. It's all right. We'll work through it. Okay. Let me go ahead and open up by starting in prayer, and then we'll get started. So, Lord, I thank you for this time. I thank you for the opportunity to teach your word, Lord Jesus, and to pour into your children, Lord, your body, according to the message that you have given me, Father. You are so good. You're so kind. You're so loving. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for watching over us, Father. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for nourishing us. I surrender all things unto you, Lord Jesus, and I just say, have your way in me. Have your way in me, Lord. I ask that every heart, every mind be prepared, Father, to receive your word. And I ask that it finds good ground inside of them to rest in, Lord. And I ask that most of all, you be glorified. In your mighty name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Okay, so the topic the Lord gave me today is about walking in love. And it blessed me when the Lord gave me this topic, because he wanted me to first start off by sharing with you guys about some of the trials I've been walking through. And then we're going to talk about this in terms of how it goes through and how it pans out in the scripture. And so the Lord simply said, just talk to my people about walking in love and what it looks like to walk in love. And so I'm going to go ahead and first start about talking about some of the trials that I'm walking through. So me and my cousin, we live together right now. We're roommates. And we have, the Lord calls it, a feud going on. And so just to give a little bit of detail about this feud that I have going on with my cousin right now, we are not talking, although we live in the same two-bedroom apartment, okay? Small two-bedroom apartment, kitchen, living room, that's it. But we're not talking, right? And it's difficult. It is very much challenging for me. And the Lord literally told me, like, daughter, I want you to carry this cross for me, but I'm going to bring you into greater insight as you carry this cross for me. And so I'm like, because of the situation that I'm facing right now with my cousin, it's causing a lot of frustration in my heart because we're not talking. And typically whenever I'm living with somebody, like, I gotta be on cool terms with them. There always gotta be some type of peace. If not, then I'm not at peace, right? And so, like, as an example, what the Lord was saying to me, he pretty much said, he said, your cousin doesn't like how you talk to her, and you don't like how she treats you. And so in my personal opinion, right, my personal opinion, the way I'm viewing this just out of my natural eyes, I am looking at her and saying, oh, you're not treating me the way that I want to be treated. You are esteeming yourself higher than me. You are not looking at me as equal as you. You know, you are thinking these things about me that are not true. And on her side, you know, from what I know a little bit about, she's talking about, hey, you're not talking to me the way I want to be talked to. Like, you're talking to me however you want to talk to me, right? So we have this feud going on. And she, out of this feud that we have going on, just decided just to be quiet and not talk to me at all. Even though I've tried, right? Even though I'm like, okay, hey, what's going on? Like, you know, how can we talk this through? Can we work this through? Can we like walk through this? Can you explain to me why you don't want to talk? Like, what's the issue on your side? And she refused to talk. And it's been a challenge. It's been a feud, right, that we've been having going on, and it's still not resolved to this present moment. It is still not resolved. But the Lord has already given me insight that through prayer, he's going to, you know, walk me through this, right? And so I'm still in it at the very moment. And so what the Lord said to me when he talked to me about this message being about walking in love, and how right now my cousin and I, we're feuding. And he said the fact that we don't like how each other is treating the next person, right? And he said to me, he says, but neither one of you are walking in love. And I'm like, okay, okay, Lord, okay. So he said, yeah, he just said straight up to me, like, neither one of you are walking in love. I'm not walking in love with her. She's not walking in love with me, right? And he said, love doesn't remember what the person did to you yesterday. And in my heart, I'm like, girl, you over here yesterday, you did such and such, such and such, 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 and I'm not liking it. And I wake up with that on my heart the next day and the next day after that, and it's still presently there. And so the Lord was saying, like, when in love, you don't remember what the person did to you yesterday, right? And then I was like, okay, Lord,
I said, well, why is it that I remember what my cousin did to me yesterday? And he said to me, he said, you want your cousin to change. And it's true. It's like, I'm holding these things in my mind. I'm like counting these things. Like, when are you going to change? When are you going to change? When are you going to change? And the Lord is like, you want her to change. So you're holding a record, right? And he said, you want her to change now. And you want her to make this change now in her life. So you're expecting this change to happen pretty much immediately. But the Lord corrected me. He said, but love endures. And he said, look at my love for you. He said, long suffering. And he said, I remember your wrongs no more. And so the Lord wanted now for us to walk through love in this aspect and understand what it is to walk in love, right? And the Lord, some of the things the Lord gave me, I'm pretty excited about. So let's go ahead and look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 4 through 8. And we're going to break this down. So I'm going to read it first. You guys know this one. Everybody's heard it before, but I'm going to read it anyway. So here we go. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4. And I'm going to read it all the way through verse 8. It says, love is patient. Love is kind. Love, it does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. What I was doing, right? Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. And so the Lord told me, okay, let's look at this line by line. And so we started looking at, the Lord told me to look at patience, right? So love is patient. So see how love is patient, what the Lord is saying. So he told me to look up the word of patience, the definition of patience. And it says, able to accept or tolerate delays, problems, or suffering without becoming annoyed or anxious. Okay, so like when I read the definition of patience, immediately I was corrected because it's just like, boy, I mean, like able to accept or tolerate delays, problems, or suffering without becoming annoyed or anxious. And I was like, wow, Lord, everything in there, I'm not tolerating the fact that my cousin's not changing immediately. I'm like, can you speed this up? Can you get this over with? Can you change now? Can you change today? I'm tired of waiting for this, right? I'm not wanting to suffer through this. I've been crying about it, like, Lord, when is this going to stop? You know? And this problem overall is annoying me, is giving me anxiety, you know? And so the Lord, when the Lord gave me this definition and I looked it up, I said, okay, Lord, I said, but how is it that someone grows in patience? Like, how do we grow in patience when you think about it? Because my mom would say, okay, Lord, I need to walk in patience. Love is patience. But how do I grow in patience? And the Lord said, he reminded me of James, right? And I'm going to read James to you guys real quick. James 1, James 1, verse 2, it says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So when the Lord said to me how someone grows in patience is by walking through trials, he gave me the word endurance and he gave me the word perseverance. Because as we go through these trials in life, perseverance and endurance is built on the inside of us. And so although we could be suffering, although we can be having problems, although we could be feuding with family members, although we could be feuding with neighbors, feuding with anybody in this world, if we have walked through trials and tribulations in our life, we will build up endurance to still be able to love the person and be patient with the person. And although we have disagreements, although we have things that we don't understand, although we have things that annoy us, the trials kind of like get rid of these things. The trials get rid of the annoyance and it builds into you patience. And so it's like, we don't want to go through trials. We're like, Lord, I don't want to go through no trials. Like, why do I got to go to this trial? Like, why is this? You know? And yet the Lord is saying, because it's going to build into you something that you need, which is patience. And so that's why he says to count it as joy, because it's doing a great work on the inside of you. And if the Lord is saying we need love, we need to learn how to walk in love, then that is exactly what we need to go through, is trials. And it says, when you face trials of many kinds, so we're going to face different types of trials in our life, not just one, because we're going to need to have all aspects of love. So let's look at the next thing where it talks about love. It says, love is kind, right? And I said, okay, Lord, like, what is kindness? I love to ask general questions. I don't need to ask something crazy, right? I just keep it real. Like, Lord, what's kindness, right? And what does it look like to be kind towards someone? And he says, it looks like you giving up your life for them and saying, I would treat you the way that I want to be treated. And I was like, wow, that's so basic, right? Like, it's so simple. Like, you giving up your life for them and saying, I would treat you the way that I want to be treated. And I was like, okay, Lord, so what does giving up your life mean in this context? And then the Lord said, look at what I did. He said, I came off the throne, gave up my dignity, right, to put you in right standing with me. And he says, me putting you in right standing with me is saying, I am washing you clean of all trespasses against me. So the Lord gave up all of his holiness, all of his glory in who he is to put on this human body so that he could be kind to us, right? Show kindness to us, love us through kindness, and wash us of all of our trespasses against him. So it's like, not against somebody else, but our trespasses against God. You know what I'm saying? And that's amazing when you really think about it. Like, and so as we think about this, and I said, okay, Lord, well, because I asked earlier, like, how do I grow in patience, right? I asked it for kindness. Like, how do I grow in kindness? And the Lord said, he says, when you will grow in kindness, when you accept my kindness for you. And it made me really pause and think about it. Like, are there areas in my life where I have not accepted the kindness of the Lord? Are there areas in my life where I'm rejecting God's love? Are there areas in my life where I'm doubting if God loves me? Because these are areas that we need to, once we accept the kindness of the Lord, we'll be able to give out the kindness of the Lord to other people as well. So let's look at love. The next one, love does not envy. And so envy, the Lord told me to look up the word envy, right? So the definition of envy, a feeling of discontented or resentful longing aroused by someone else's possessions, qualities, or luck. And so when I heard that one, immediately the Lord brought back up to me. So I want to read that again one more time. Envy, the definition of envy is, a feeling of discontented or resentful longing aroused by someone else's possessions, quality, or luck. So when I read that definition, immediately the Holy Spirit brought up to me the prodigal son. And then he showed me the prodigal son, the one that was in the house. Because when the son returned back home, who already had, like, wasted his riches and his wealth and his inheritance on riotous living, the prodigal son that was in the house, and he saw his brother come back and he saw his father being so good and so kind to him, he was envious. He was envious of the blessings that his father was giving his brother. He was envious of the status that his father gave his brother. Like, his father brought his brother back up to a high status with him, right? He didn't keep his son down. He brought him back up and restored unto him his place where he belonged from the beginning. And so the brother who was in the house was envious because he didn't realize he already had everything that his brother was receiving from his father. He was envious because the son that was in the house and we know this by the story, right? Because he was like, the son that was in the house told his father, I've been working for you all these years, and you have never given me a calf for to celebrate with my friends. And he's like, son, like, everything I have is yours. What are you talking about? And so we see that the son inside the house had no real grasp that he already had everything. So he didn't have to envy his brother, because the possessions already belonged to him. And so when we envy somebody, it's because we don't recognize that everything that is God's is ours. We already have the inheritance because of Jesus Christ and everything he did for us on the cross. And so when God says love does not envy, it's because we recognize the love of God, the kindness of God towards us. And so when we see something around in this world that somebody else has, when we truly recognize that God has already blessed us and God has already given us the any and everything we need, if we ask him, we won't have this longing for something that somebody else has. We won't have this longing in our heart to be like, I want to have that person's status. I want to have this person's car. I want to have that person's house. If we want it, we ask God for it. If we want it, God will give it to us. If we ask God for it and it's in his will, he will pour it out to us because it's going to bring him glory. We're going to praise him. We're going to thank him, but it's going to be in his perfect timing because he's not going to give a gift to us that will harm us, right? Because our God is, our Father is love. And so when we look at envy, it's really recognizing first, do you believe that God blesses you? Do you believe that all of your everything you need comes from God? Do you believe that everything that God loves you? Do you believe that God will provide for you, right? Looking at the next one, love does not boast. So the definition, when I looked up boast, it says, talk with excessive pride and self-satisfaction about one's achievements, possessions, or abilities. Now, when I read this definition, like, it corrected my heart. I was like, oh, okay, Lord, like, I'll be doing this sometimes, right? And it was, I just had to be honest, like, I'll be doing that sometimes. And I was just like, wow, like, really, wow, yeah, I'll be doing it sometimes, but I'd be really excited, right? And so I'm gonna read it again. It says the definition of boast. It says talk with excessive pride and self-satisfaction about one's achievements, possessions, or abilities. And I was like, okay, I said, okay, Lord, I hear the definition. And I was like, okay, Lord, but why would someone boast? Like, why do people boast when I think about it, right? And he said, you want the attention to be given to you, my love. And he says, you want the applause. You want the glory. You want people to be like, yay, look at what you did. Praise God. You know, like, you want that. And so when you're boasting, it's like you're craving it. You're desiring attention. You're desiring the glory. You're desiring the applause, and you're like, look at what I did. Somebody praised me. Yay. I'm doing such a great thing, you know? And so I was like, okay. But then I began to ask the Lord about like thirsting after it. But then he wanted me to proceed further to talk about the next one. So I'm gonna move forward and I'm gonna wrap this together in terms of those two. So the next one says love is not proud. So I looked up the definition of pride. It says a feeling or deep pleasure. It's a longer definition, but the Holy Spirit stopped me right there. It says a feeling or deep pleasure. So pride is a feeling or a deep pleasure. And then the Lord stopped me and he said, this is why you boast. You want a feeling of deep pleasure. He says, but you get your pleasure and satisfaction from me. So God is the only one who can really please our soul. He's the only one that can bring satisfaction to our soul. But yet we are boasting to try to be satisfied in our soul. And God is like, you don't have to do that. Come to me and I will satisfy you. Right. And so it made me think, okay, Lord. Okay. So I was like, okay. So I said, okay, Lord. So you're saying I get my satisfaction from you and you are the only one who can really please my soul. And I said, well, what is it? Like, how is that possible? And the Lord said, he said, you get your satisfaction and pleasure from me by doing what I created you for. So that was amazing because it's encouraging to agree with the purpose the Lord has given to you. And it's encouraging to obey the Lord because the Lord is saying, if you obey me, You will be satisfied in the works that I'm giving to you. If you obey me, you will have pleasure in the works that I'm giving to you. There are going to be some challenges, but yet there's still going to be satisfaction that's coming from it, right? And then the Lord reminded me of the scripture where he was at the well, right? He was talking to the woman at the well. And then once he was done talking to the woman at the well and she ran off to go tell the rest of her friends, I'll call them. And then his disciples came back to him, right? And they was like, Lord, you know, they was like, Lord, here, you know, eat some food. You haven't eaten in a long time. Eat some food. And then the Lord was like, what? You know, I'll read the scripture to you guys real quick. He said, my food is John 4, verse 34. He said, my food. He says, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his works. And so what the Lord was showing me is that we sometimes look to food to also bring pleasure and satisfaction to us. And that was deep. Because I'm like, I know there's been many times that I've been annoyed or been anxious. And I'm like over here eating all types of food, all types of stuff, just to try to bring some kind of satisfaction to my soul, right? But it never satisfies me. It never satisfies us because it's like we want more of the food. We want more of the food. We thirst after more of the junk food, right? And so the Lord was saying, like, our food, what brings pleasure to us, what brings satisfaction to us, is to do his will. So you won't be thirsting after food in the natural, like all the junk food that we like to eat to try to bring, make ourselves happy. And you also won't be thirsting after that unseen food, which is the applause and the glory that people give you as well. You won't be thirsting after none of it, because when you're doing God's will and you're walking in who you are, you're going to be satisfied. You're going to be happy. You're going to be joyful. You're going to be like, praise the Lord. What you want me to do next, Lord? Like, what you want me to do? Okay. Like, you're going to be happy because that's what God says in his word. And it's true. If you really think about, like, if God told you to do something, if any moment, just think about one moment where the Lord gave you instructions to do something for him and you obeyed it. Did you not feel joyful after doing that? Like, did you not feel full on the inside? Did you not feel satisfied on the inside? Did you not be like, whoa, I'm just so elated? Because it's true. Like, when you do God's will, that is what satisfies your soul. That is what brings pleasure to you. That is what makes you happy. That is what makes you joyful. So praise God. The next one, love does not dishonor others. And so the Lord said it to me a different way. He said, love honors my love. So he said, love honors. And so I was like, and so I was listening to what he was saying. He was like, yeah, love honors. And he was like, he says, when you love someone, don't you tell everybody about them? And I was like, dang, that's true. Yeah, that's true. When you love somebody, you tell everybody about them. Like, whoa, look what they did. Aren't they so great? They did these great things. You're just talking about them all the time. Like, when you love somebody, you're constantly giving out, you know, like praise reports to about them to other people. When you love somebody, you're constantly saying, wow, man, yeah, I'm talking about them all the time. You loving them. You're constantly giving them honor. So when you love somebody, you are constantly honoring them all the time. And so the Lord was saying, he corrected me. He says, this is how I want you to treat your cousin. He says, tell everybody about the good things about her, not the bad things. And so, because in our annoyance, when we're mad, when we're upset, when we are frustrated, we talk about all the bad things about people. We don't talk about none of the good stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, we talk about all the bad things. We just like, and they did this, and they did this to me, and they did that to me, and they did this to me. We're mad, right? We're not moving in patience. We're not moving in kindness. We're not moving in, we're moving in boasting about things that makes us satisfied, right? But God is saying, I want you to honor. He says, love honors. So we're supposed to be talking about all the good things about people all the time. And he says, but then the Lord corrected me. He was like, yeah, this is how you treat your sister. Meaning like my other sister, I honor her. He says, this is how you treat your sister. He says, when she did things you didn't agree with, he said, did you go around telling everybody about it? or did you cover it up? And I was like, ooh, okay, Lord. Okay. I covered it because I was like, I don't want to hurt my sister. I love her. I don't want to hurt my sister. I love her. And God is like, now I want you to treat your cousin the same way. And I'm like, okay. Like, and then what started coming out of my heart was like, oh, but I'm frustrated, you know? But praise God, because he's going to walk us through it. We're learning to walk in love, right? So love honors. The next one is love is not self-seeking. And so he says, this one was interesting to me because I was like, love is not self-seeking. I had to really kind of pray and be like, okay, Lord, what you talking about? Love is not self-seeking. He says, someone who is self-seeking, what do they look like? And I was like, what do they look like? And he told me to ask him to show me. So he showed me. And he showed me the person who is self-seeking is a wanderer. They're constantly just wandering around the earth, wandering around the earth, right? And he says they wander away. He says they take a step away from everyone. And I was like, wow, that's true. Because it's like, even when we're self-seeking and when we're wanting to like distance ourselves from other people, are we seeking God or are we seeking to satisfy ourselves? Are we seeking the Lord and what he wants? Or are we seeking like, you know, what we desire and how we feel and we're caught up in our emotions, right? And so he says, love is not self-seeking. And a person who is self-seeking is a wanderer. And when I looked up the word wanderer, it says a person who travels aimlessly. So they don't have any destination in mind. They're pretty much lost. And the Lord said it. He said, he said to me, he says, yeah, a person who travels aimlessly. And he said, who is shepherding and who are they being shepherded by? So when somebody is self-seeking, they wander aimlessly about the earth, but who is their shepherd? It's their self. So wherever they want to go, whatever they want to do, whatever they want to say, whatever they want to be around, whatever place they want to see, they're self-seeking. They are literally seeking themselves, saying, self, what should I do today? Self, what should I do tomorrow? When God is saying, I want to be your shepherd, and he is the God of love. And so obviously if this person is self-seeking, this person is not walking in love. And then the Lord said, those who wander are lost. Those who wander are lost. And I was like, wow, okay. So love is not self-seeking. And then the Lord gave me, he said, love is not easily angered. And then he repeated it. Love is not easily angered. And he says, so when love is not easily angered, love is not looking for anything to hold against you. I mean, like, he says, so it's not easily pushed over the edge when you do something wrong. Now, when we are not walking in love, we are calculating, we're searching for things to hold against you. We like, what you do today, what you about to do right now, we're watching everything you're doing, and we're looking to just get angry at you and snap at you and be like, this is why I said this, and this is why you would, and this is why. We're just looking for something to be easily angered by. But God is saying love is not easily angered. It's not out here searching for something to hold against you. And he said, everyone who is easily angered is because they are in unforgiveness. So they have literally a record chart in their subconscious, in their mind, of all the things that you have done wrong and against them. And now they're just like tallying the whole chart. You know what I'm saying? And they're just like, oh, he did that yesterday. Oh, he did that today. Okay, here you go now. You know, so it's like, it tells you that you're walking in unforgiveness when you're easily angered, because you're keeping a tally of everything that the person did. And it's just like, they doing it again. Okay, I'm easily angered. They're doing it again. Okay, I'm easily angered. But God is saying love is not easily angered. Love keeps no records of wrongs. And then, so he tied this together to the one before. He says, keeping a record of wrongs breeds anger in those that are recording. And so if you are a person who struggles with anger, it's because you are keeping records of wrongdoings. And this literally breeding it, because you're constantly having to remember it in your mind. You're constantly meditating on it. You're remembering every single thing that the person did. And so it's literally breeding anger in your heart. And that's why you're so easily angered, because it's, you have a record going on in your mind. You have a record going on. Yeah, throw away them records. We got to throw the records away, you know? But the Lord is so good, because the Lord said, he gave me insight. It was like, the Lord is not angry with you. He's not angry with us, because he has no records against us. Praise God. Because of everything Jesus Christ did on the cross, all of the records of our wrongs was washed clean by the blood and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So it shows you, it puts Jesus' way of living and our way of living up against each other, right? And so you get to see how God is, it encourages me, because it's like you can come to God and know that he's not going to be angry with you. Like, you can come to God and know that he's going to be loving towards you. You can come to God and know that he's just going to be like, how can I help you? I want to help you. I want to give you some life. I want to give you life. I want to give you life more abundantly. God is not angry with you. And he loves you. And your confidence in this is the fact that, yes, Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, but that that erased all the records. So God does not have anger boiling in his heart for everything that you could have, that you think you may have done wrong. God is not angry with you. He loves you. This one blessed me. So the next one says, love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. And so the Lord said it to me like this. He said, love does not delight in revenge. Justice is not revenge. And I was like, okay, Lord, what are we talking about? Okay. And so I looked at the definition of revenge. And it says, the action of inflicting hurt or harm to someone for an injury or wrong suffered at their hand. So it's like tit for tat. It's like eye for an eye. I'm going to read it again. So definition of revenge, the action of inflicting hurt or harm on someone for an injury or wrong suffered at their hands. And so he says, love does not delight in revenge. And it's like when we're hurt, a lot of times we're wanting revenge. We're like, Lord, get them. We're like, Lord, hurt them the way that they hurt me. A lot of times we're wanting revenge for that, right? But the Lord is saying, like, revenge is not what he wants. So love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. And so when I looked at, when the Lord gave me this, it made me really stop to think about a couple of things. And so I'm just going to like reference the book of Acts. It's Acts chapter 7, verse 54 through 60. And this is actually the time in which Stephen was preaching the gospel to the Sanhedrin, and they didn't like what he was saying. And so they literally dragged Stephen out of the city and stoned Stephen right there. Like, they plugged their ears. They're like, I don't want to hear nothing else you got to say. They plugged up their ears, and they didn't want to hear nothing else. And so they dragged Stephen out of the city and stoned him. And what does Stephen cry out? Stephen said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He said, Lord, do not hold this against them. And so Stephen wasn't keeping a record of wrong in his heart. And he didn't cry out for revenge when he was getting stoned for doing something just in God's eyes. Stephen wasn't crying out to say, Lord, they stoned me. I want you to stone them. Stephen wasn't crying out to say, Lord, they hurt me. I want you to hurt them. I want you to punish them. Stephen wasn't crying out to God saying that. He said, Lord, do not hold this against them. And he said, receive my spirit. And then we know what Jesus Christ said, forgive them for they know not what they do. And so when we're looking at the fact that love does not delight in evil, love is about not asking God to revenge or to cause harm that was done to you upon someone else, right? And so let me say it like this. But the ending part of that says, but rejoices with the truth. So love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. And so the Lord said to me, he says, there are evil things that incite people like all the time. There are evil things that are inciting people all the time. When you think about the thoughts that run through your mind, and you know some of those thoughts are crazy, or you know some of the things that you may think in your heart, maybe like, okay, Lord, I don't know if this is good, but there are things that incites us all the time, right? And he says, when the enemy is exposed, the person is set free, and the enemy is bound, this is the truth, and you are supposed to rejoice in this. And so it is important that we see, he says, and that is justice, my love. So God's eyes and his viewpoint about justice is recognizing who is behind the act. And a lot of these times, it is not the person. It is the thing that is inciting the person to do that act that God is seeking to come against, that God is seeking to put in its place. And so God knows what's truly inciting someone. And God says, love rejoices when the truth is exposed and when the truth is actually found out and the enemy is bound and the person is set free. God wants to bind up every single enemy, every single devil, every single evil spirit that is inciting you to do these things. He wants that to be bound. He wants you to be set free. And he wants us, as in his children, to rejoice at that time. He doesn't want to have people over here bound up and perishing. That's not what God wants. He wants everybody to come to him and to find love in him and to actually have eternal life through him. That's why he sent his son to die on a cross for us, so that we could be forgiven and the enemy, Satan, could be put down into everlasting burning fires, not his children. And so we should be crying out to God to free the people who are doing the things that are wrong because their soul is being incited by evil things. And that is a soul that Jesus Christ died for. And God wants us to be praying for these people, helping these people, loving these people, being patient with these people, not keeping a record of wrongs in our heart. God knows, and he knows also how to hold people accountable. So I'm not saying God is just going to push everything to the side. There are consequences for our actions, but yet God wants us to be on the side of love. God wants us to rejoice when the enemy is bound and the human being is set free. Praise God. And so the Lord said to me, he said, and this is forgiving the unforgivable. This is like forgiving the unforgivable. That is what true love is. It's those things that we think are just like, Lord, they just did something so crazy. I don't never want to forgive them for that. And God is like, forgive the unforgivable. So whatever unforgivable is in your heart, God wants you to forgive it, right? 70 times 7 per day. And it's deep when you really think about it, because it exposes the need for us to grow in love, and then it exposes the need for us to walk through trials. And so that's why we're supposed to be rejoicing, like, Lord, yes, another trial, praise God, I'm going to grow in love. I'm going to grow in patience, you know? It's amazing. And Jesus forgave the unforgivable on the cross. He forgave the unforgivable on the cross. That was every human being, because we all went against him. And so the next part sums this up. It says, love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. And he said, love is a weapon against darkness. Love never fails. So if you want to defeat darkness in your life, in your family's life, in anybody's life, in your city, in your neighborhood, in your country, across the world, love is a weapon against darkness. And in the end, love will be that remains. Faith, hope, and love remains in the end. So the most powerful weapon is love. And love will never fail you. I think about so many times when I have done something wrong, whether it's to people, whether it's to God, whether whatever it is, at that moment of receiving love from that person, I had the greatest desire to turn away from everything that I was doing that was wrong. So love is powerful to change the world, because it did what Jesus Christ used it on the cross. And so praise God. And so the Lord drew me to look at those that are rioting and those that are protesting. And he was saying in their heart, they're seeking love. He says they want equality, but equality is love. They want peace, but peace is love. They want justice, but justice is love. And so the Lord was saying to me, like, I want you to see that when an enemy incites you against your neighbor, it is to draw you away from me. So when you're incited against your neighbor, the enemy wants to draw you away from God, because he knows the more you spend time with God, the more you hang out with God, you're going to be falling in love with God, which is going to cause you to love your neighbor. And then you're going to have power over Satan's kingdom. And he's like, no, I don't want that. So when you feel in your heart that you are incited against your neighbor, it is a moment to recognize and cry out to God, like, Lord, help me to love this person. How do I love this person? Why is it that I'm challenged with loving this person? What do I need to learn? How do I need to respond? What scriptures are going to help me? Help me to pray, Lord. Help me to accept your love so that I may receive your love and then give it out. And so the Lord has given us plenty of opportunity to love our neighbor. So I encourage you to do this. Now, the one thing that I wanted to also close with is a scripture that's 1 John chapter 4, verse 10. It says, this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. So God is our best example of love. God is our best example. And so now we know we can count our trials as joy, because it is working patience in us. And if we don't have patience, all of those other things of love, not boasting, not being proud, not honoring, self-seeking, all these other things, if we don't have patience, we won't be able to move in all the other aspects of love, because patience is like the root that allows you to suffer through all the other things you're going to have to endure in order to love someone. And so our kingdom as a Christian, as a believer, as a follower of Jesus Christ, we endure suffering with joy. We endure suffering and cry out to the Lord for understanding. And as we endure this, it is producing a tree full of fruits of love. It is producing a tree of fruits in our heart, in our walk. We'll be able to walk in love, not just talk it, but walk in love. And it's going to come by just living life and crying out to the Lord Jesus Christ, because you're going to go through some trials. And these trials are going to definitely, like, bring in patience and bring in love. So I praise God. I praise God. Be encouraged to know that God definitely loves you. And that's the greatest of these. It's not that we love God. It's not that we you know, are doing all these works for God, but it's first recognizing that God loved us. So all of these different things that it talks about, love is patience, love is kind, love does not boast. That first is how God treats you. God is patient with you. God is kind towards you. God is not over here a God that's like trying to, you know what I mean? Like trying to just do stuff that just doesn't make sense. I'll say it like that. Like God, you know, he honors us, which is amazing when you think about it. Like he honors us. You know, God is pleased with us as children. God doesn't keep any records of our wrongs. God is not easily angered. He's not over here delighting in evil. He's not siding with the enemy's kingdom against you. God is on your side. So the Lord first loved you, and now he just wants us to go and love our neighbors. So praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I really hope that this blessed you all. Suki had a question? Oh, I'm sorry. Where's the question? There were so many comments going on. I missed it. If you don't mind typing your question, I'll answer it for you from Matthew 24. Matthew 24. Explain Matthew 24, verse 12. Explain Matthew 24, verse 12. So Matthew 24, verse 12, it says, because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. And then verse 13 says, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. So the Lord is saying to me, I'll ask him how to explain it to you. How do you want me to explain it, Lord Jesus? So it says, because the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. It's that person is not knowing how to endure. So as right now in our country, in our state, there is a lot of evil going on, and there's a lot of evil being presented to our face. But it goes back to the beginning of what the Lord was saying, love is patient. So when you are keeping a record in your heart and you're keeping records of all the wrongs that have been done against you, your love is going to grow cold, meaning you're not going to be walking in love. It's not going to be flaming. You're not going to be honoring your neighbor. You're not going to be talking so great and highly about your neighbor. Instead, you're going to be talking opposite. You're going to be dishonoring them because the love on the inside of you doesn't know how to endure. But the endurance comes from gaining understanding. The endurance comes, yes, you're going through, but you're not just going through and not reading your word. You're not just going through and not crying out to God. You're not just going through and seeking your own understanding. You have to go through the trials, but you are walking with Jesus Christ. And so the Lord wants us to walk with him through these trials. And as we walk with him through these trials, he will give us understanding that will cause our love to increase and our patience to increase. And he will give us hope so that we can endure the difficulties and not have our love grow cold. Hopefully that answers your question. But yeah, it's about walking with the Lord. We don't have strength on our own. Without Jesus Christ, we can't produce anything. Without Jesus Christ, we can't produce anything. And so if we're trying to live our life, because I'll take you back to what it said, right? Love is not self-seeking. And so what did the Lord talk about in self-seeking? A person who is self-seeking is literally wandering aimlessly about the earth. They're seeking their own mind, their own understanding. And God is saying, but you're supposed to seek ye first the kingdom of God and my righteousness, and all of these things will be added to you. And so everything that you are actually wanting in life, right? We want to be provided for. We want to have clothes. We want to have shoes, right? We want to be, we want our families to be safe. There was a scripture that talks about this. It's actually Matthew 25. It's kind of right next door to the one that you asked about. But yeah, like Matthew 25 talks about, Matthew 6, verse 25 and 33, talks about, like to not take any thought for our lives. So let me just read that to you because I wrote that one down, but I didn't talk about it. So praise God. I guess he wants me to talk about it. Is Matthew 6 verses 25 through 33. And it says, it's titled, Do Not Worry. So it says, therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. Do they not sow or weep or stow away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them? Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you by worrying add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow, and tomorrow it is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? O ye of little faith. So do not worry, saying, what should we eat, or what should we drink, or what should we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And so the Lord summed that up for me by saying, like, just move. It's about moving away from selfishness, because your heavenly Father knows everything you need. And it's about seeking after God for his love, because it is his love that brought you into right standing. And his love is what adds all of these things to you to begin with. So everything you need, clothes, shoes, shelter, everything you need is added unto you because God loves you. Simple as that. And so that's why we seek after God, because we're seeking after the God of love. We're seeking after the God of love. And his love is what educates us and teaches us how to love others. I was reading what Pastor said. He said you're dealing with the issues of the heart. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And by the Lord's Spirit, and by his power, by his love for you, it'll change you. So praise God. Praise the Lord. We're just about at our time. Did I miss any other questions? If not, if there are no questions, then I will close by just blessing you all. Pastor saying, yeah, your heart issues, release them to God. Yes, give it over to God. Like, there are times when my heart is heavy. Like, there are times when I woke up with a heavy heart. And literally, I just had to say, like, Lord, I give this situation to you. I can't even handle it. You take it, Lord, because I don't even know what to do with this thing. But help me. Help me, okay? Help me, please. I don't know what to do, but I release every single thing on my heart and I'm throwing it to you. And God takes it. He takes you at your word. So if you say, Lord, I give this to you, and you speak it out of your mouth, the Lord takes it at your word. It's true. He takes you at your word. So I'm going to have to refresh. I don't mind coming back, Erica. I'm going to refresh. I just got 20 seconds here and then it's going to quit on me because I'm at an hour, but I'll refresh real quick to come back and see if anybody else has questions. So join back in just a minute. I think she was getting an answer from the pastor.
Okay, cool.
I saw her on her phone.
Okay. I'll send a message.
Let me know if you have questions. They weren't saved before, and I'm sure I probably missed them, so.
Billy, can you hear me?
Jersey, I can hear you, and we can talk again.
Yeah, let me know if you guys have questions. That's why I came back on. The message is complete, but praise God. Praise the Lord. So the releasing it to the Lord and not picking it back up, how does one do that was the question. Yeah, so releasing it and not picking it back up to the Lord. That's a good one because I know I had that question and I had to ask it to the Lord many times. There is, so I'll try to do my best to make it simple for you. So as we were talking about earlier, giving it to the Lord and just confessing out of your mouth, like, Lord, I'm releasing this situation to you. Now it's about meditating on the word of God and getting the word of God on the inside of you, because the word of God is your weapon to fight against everything that will want to stop you from walking in love, which is darkness. And so if you really want to stay in love, you got to war against everything that will try to get you out of love. And the way you war is by literally the word. That is your weapon. And that's the best thing I can offer to you. So the more you listen to the word of God, play the word of God. Sometimes I go to sleep and I'll just play the Bible. Sometimes I'll play the Bible, whatever. Sometimes whatever, as much as I can. It's about listening to the word of God, because as you listen to the word of God, faith comes by hearing. And if you need to believe God, you need to have faith in the Lord. It's going to come by hearing. So you got to listen to the word. You got to read that word, get that word on the inside of you, because the more you hear it, it's going to work against every single thing on the inside of you. And it's going to bring you into belief. It's going to bring you into faith, and it's going to give you understanding. And then so as you listen to the word of God, it's going to keep you in the place of, staying in love, walking in love. And it's about just literally walking with the Lord every day. Every day you walk with the Lord is molding you and shaping you. And it's not something that will happen overnight, nor does God expect it to be something overnight. There is glory to the Lord by walking you through these things. And there are some things he does overnight, but like, it's really about getting the word on the inside of you. And yes, there are people. So the comments are all, everybody's speaking truth in the comments too. So yes, believing. And if you have a hard time believing, asking the Lord for belief. If you have a hard time having faith, ask the Lord to help you to have faith. Believing, speaking, the word, prayer, all of it. Do as much as you can. And if at any time you're struggling, also fellowship with your brothers and sisters. Fellowship with your brothers and sisters too. And yes, and no matter what you're going through, trusting the Lord. The Lord has us, even in the most challenging times. So even after you did everything you can to stand in the Lord that he loves you and trust him. Because it's true. It's true. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anything else, Lord, I should share? Yeah. That's it, the Lord says. The Lord says to bless you all and to tell you good night. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The message will be saved, too, on the IGTV for our church IG account. So if you want to listen back to this, it's saved. I already have it up there. So I pray that you guys are blessed, that you sleep in peace, and that you go with the Lord, and that you're just blessed abundantly. Praise the Lord. Good night.